It's not just about him, but that it's about the team.
Yes, I'm happy he referred to a report and he mentioned some names. These are the names that he mentioned. These are their signatures. This report was to look, the committee that was set up, 3 members from ASU, 3 members from the other side. Those 3 members are here. They have signed. When they presented this report, they identified sources of funding for the university system in Nigeria. The first statement Dr. Wale Babalakin made was, this is unrealistic and it is unworkable. Is he respecting those people he presented in glowing terms by making that kind of statement? This report is unrealistic and it is unworkable. Why? Because they rejected his idea of escalating tuition fees on our campuses. I can read the section where what they said,
Before you read that section, because he also said that ASU presented the position, and in that position, they came up with a figure, he said it was $3,365 per student. And when they broke it down, that's in trillions. And he says, look, if that's the case, then we might as well seek alternative sources of funding because government doesn't have that amount of money in trillions
Chamberlain, to give to education. Chamberlain, that was what led to the setting up of this committee. That we work together. He is now attributing it to us. We don't even deny it.
Okay.
We need massive injection.
We'll read that part that you were talking about when we come back in a moment. Okay. Join us again. All right, Pop, go ahead. Read to us the clause you refer to.
Yes. On tuition fees, the subcommittee notes that tuition fees could be a potential source of university funding. However, recognizing that students are already incurring costs through service charges paid to universities, purchase of learning materials, and personal upkeep, the current state of endemic poverty in the country, in which about 60% of the population lives in multidimensional poverty, that attendant very high funding gap from the existing government allocation in relation to the expected student contribution through tuition fees, the subcommittee recommends that the extant policy of non-payment of undergraduate tuition fees be upheld. Right. And that was the point at which he said no.
So was this report presented and approved at plenary?
It was presented at the plenary, but we are saying this is the report of a joint team.
So was it approved? Did they both approve
they,
it?
They all signed.
Is signing the same thing as approving it?
Pardon?
Both teams.
Well, it may not be as approving it, but the chairperson was already biased. So it wouldn't allow for open discussion.
Okay, so this has not been agreed by both parties as of yet?
It was not agreed upon because he rejected it from the onset. And that was when he said, I will present my own position. If it means writing a minority report, how can the chairman of a negotiating committee say, I will write a minority report? At one point in the course of our deliberations, this man said, we wanted to set up another subcommittee. He said, I will chair it myself. Is that a vote of confidence on members of his team?
So what is the bone of contention? Because you say the 2009 is not the problem, but it's different from that of the MOA that was signed in 2017. Could you shed some light on that?
No, he said it was different.
But is it?
No, it is not. You see, what has been happening is that since 2009, government has always said, well, we cannot fully implement this area. This agreement. And in any negotiation, once we produce a document, if any party is going to default, the onus is on that party to invite the other party.
Yeah, but is there any particular funds that was supposed to have been released now that has not been released?
Yes. You see, in 2013, after the NIST assessment report, we said 2009 agreement says that government will need to inject 1.5 trillion into the system in order to revamp the university system. Government said, no, we could not do that. So they carried out the NIST assessment. We came back with the figure of 1.3. It was still from the same agreement. And that led to 2013. So when government was still not implementing 2017, we said, yes, government, you have not even fulfilled what you promised after the NIST assessment. So we came back again to look at the document, and we came down to what we needed to do. So government promised to release immediately 20 billion as a mark of commitment, in order to demonstrate that it has not repudiated the MOU of 2013. So at that point, we were expecting that government will at least fulfill that and go ahead with following with tranches that were outstanding.
All right, well, we need to wrap this up, Prof. But if you're not happy with the federal government's negotiating team or with Dr. Babalakin, have you made that position known to the government? How do we move forward with this quickly?
Yes, we met on Thursday, 15th November, and we made that clear. Before then, we had met the Honorable Minister. We had made our position known. We had written three letters communicating this to government. It was when government was not responding that we said, well, our member said, no, we cannot afford to.
But can you pick that. And choose for government who they bring and who they don't bring?
Even in a law court, you can say you don't want a judge. It is valid.
All right. Speaker, Professor Abiodun Oyeyemi is the president of ASUU. Thank you for coming on this morning. I do hope that this is really sorted out so that students can get back to school. Well, that's the show today. We thank you all for watching. We'll see you tomorrow. I'm Chamberlain Osa.
I'm Neil Taigbe. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Have a great day, everybody. I am Ajuri Ngelale. Thanks for watching.
The views and opinions expressed by guests on this program are those of the maker and do not necessarily reflect the views, opinions, and endorsement of Channels Television.